my name is Dr. Padilla. I'm a professor in computer science and psychology, and I've been a professor for over 5 years now. On this channel, I like to give you tips and tricks for being successful in academia and applying to graduate school. In this video, I wanted to give you my top 10 list of items that you should consider when selecting a PhD advisor. And I would consider this my ultimate PhD advisor checklist. So let's jump on in. Okay, number one item on my checklist is research alignment. I think the number one thing you need to consider is, does what you want to do align with what the professor is currently doing? And it might seem tricky to figure that out, but you want to make sure that what you want to study matches as closely as possible to what the advisor wants you to study. Because what will happen is they will slowly kind of encourage you or nudge you to study more of what's interesting to them, in part because they're paying you, or maybe the grants require a particular project. But in any case, if there's a misalignment between what you want to research and what your professor or your advisor wants to research, there will be some conflicts and that will be hard to resolve. The second item on my checklist is expertise. Okay, so maybe your research aligns very well. Maybe you want to study a particular topic and so does this particular advisor, but maybe they don't have the expertise to do this. And I see this with a ton of younger professors and faculty where they have aspirations of moving into a particular field, but they don't have the expertise yet to do it. So when you're in a situation like that, where the work that you want to do, the professor doesn't actually have that expertise, you're gonna be on your own to some degree to figure it out. Now, in the PhD process, there's a lot of figuring out and learning on your own, but you don't wanna set yourself up where the majority of your work, you just have to figure out on your own, because it comes with some additional downsides. If they don't have that particular expertise, they might not be able to guide you in the project. They might not be able to warn you about pitfalls that might be easily perceived. They might not know what journals to publish in. They might not know what is important to address within that research. Really, you're just kind of going in blind there as if you're doing the PhD on your own. So make sure that what you want to study, at least some major component of it, your advisor has expertise in. The third item on my checklist is the department that your advisor is in. Most people don't know how important it is to have a PhD in a particular field. And I'm telling you, it actually is quite important. So maybe you have a PhD advisor that studies a great topic you're excited about, but it's in a department where you're not necessarily wanting to get a job in that kind of department in the future. What will happen is after you graduate with your PhD, if you want to go into academia, you might be stuck to some degree to applying to jobs within that department. And some departments are a little snootier than others. So for example, some of the harder science departments, they look down on some of the softer science departments, even when they're contributing to those other fields. So it'd be very hard to get a position in one of those harder science departments if you have a PhD from a softer department. Now, that's not to say it's impossible. My PhD is in cognitive neuroscience and I'm in a computer science field, but I see it happen when we're interviewing people all of the time where people can be less sure about a candidate if they've gotten their PhD in a different department than what they're applying to. So just think very carefully about which department the particular potential advisor is in before applying. The next four items on my checklist all relate to mentorship style. The first one is time. Every professor or potential advisor will have a different amount of time they can spend on you. You want them to spend as much time as possible. You might be very independent, and so you might want, you know, a little bit more distance, but I am telling you, you will want more time than they have available. So there's things that cut down on time. If they have more graduate students, their time just gets sectioned out. If they have postdocs, if they run a big lab, if they have many grants, if they teach a lot of classes, and on and on. So you want to find an advisor with as much possible time to mentor you specifically. And what you will find is that different advisors will have different strategies in terms of how they allocate their time. One advisor might have a really big lab and have big weekly meetings with everyone, where they are really just meeting with everyone as a group, and you will get very little one-on-one time with that particular advisor. Some advisors want to be very hands-on and they meet with each person individually. You want to figure out how much time they have for you, and I guarantee you the more time they have for you, the better. Now, this goes hand in hand with time, and that's energy. There's some advisors that have lots of energy for mentorship. They really invest a lot of their personal time and energy into mentorship, and others don't. So it could be a situation where you're applying to work with someone who has all the time in the world, but they don't have energy to work with you. So you need to find someone who is excited, who's really engaged with what you're doing and wants to support your success. One of the things that I've noticed is that younger professors tend to have more energy, even if they don't have more time, because their career success is contingent on your career success. So when people's goals align, that's a really good situation. That's not always the case though. Some more senior faculty have lots of energy for mentorship, but it definitely does vary. Some just don't, okay? And one of the ways to figure this out is to talk to their current graduate students, talk to the other people in labs or that have worked with them in the past, and you'll start to get a sense for how much energy they're going to invest into working with you specifically. All right, on to number 7, and that is lab structure. This relates to time, and what you'll see is that some professors will have a very rigorous structure where there's a hierarchy. They're at the top, and maybe under them are postdocs, under them are PhD students, under those master's students, and then undergrads, where you're going to spend the most amount of time with someone a step above or below you, and the majority of the mentorship that is given to you will be from someone above you, and then you will be expected to give mentorship to someone below you. Okay, if that makes sense. Now that's completely fine, but you need to recognize that you will not get as much one-on-one mentorship with your advisor in that type of lab structure. You get all sorts of other types of opportunities, like learning to mentor yourself, but it is a different structure and you have to make sure you like that type of approach. Another approach is to have more of a flat organization where everyone's at about the same level and everyone gets equal access to a particular advisor. That may or may not work for you. I just want you to know that you should think about that when you are evaluating the different types of labs that you could be applying to work in. 8th item on my list is related, and that is lab culture. Lab culture is all about the environment that you'll be working in. And why this is related to a checklist for your advisor is because it will give you a clue about how that type of advisor works. If they create a very warm and welcoming lab culture, they tend to be warm and welcoming people themselves. If they're rigorous, high stress, you know, really deadline oriented, performance oriented, you will start to see that within the lab culture as well. So when you go and you interview and you start speaking with these people, pay attention to how the lab feels. What are the vibes in the lab? And that will give you a clue about the person who put that lab together and how they're running it. And ultimately you want a lab that matches your own personal style. So whatever it is, just try to find a fit between that particular culture and when you will be the most successful. Okay, the second to last item on my ultimate advisor checklist is communication style. I think this is a really pivotal one that often gets overlooked, in part for me because I think communication style is key. And I often find the most conflicts happen with me and students or me with other faculty when we don't have the same communication style. When I mean communication style, this is expectations about how quickly you'll respond, when you'll respond, how you'll respond, and the nature by which you'll respond. So in terms of how quickly, you will see based on how they're responding to your communications, if they respond immediately, they will expect you to respond immediately. So just recognize that that's an expectation. You really want to think about matching their style. And if you can't match their style, it's probably not a very good fit. For example, maybe they are all about email and you want to be on Slack and Discord, okay? You cannot get them to change what they're doing. You have to kind of fit into what they're doing. So you want to make sure that there's an alignment there. Another one is, how do we communicate about deadlines? How are we all on the same page about when things need to get done? How are those tasks organized? Are we sending email reminders? Are there calendar reminders? You know, how on top of it are we staying? All these things are little items, but they tend to add up when you start to have this misconnection with communication styles. And truly, I think the number one thing that really sinks someone's PhD experience is if they have a different communication style than their advisor. And what I tend to see is they can't understand why they can't get on the same page with that particular advisor. And it's usually that they're not communicating in the same way that the advisor expects. So the way to really evaluate this is in every interaction, evaluate how they're communicating with you. Are they direct? Are they indirect? How fast do they respond? How do they respond? Do they respond in really long lists with lots of detail, or are they more vague? All of those things, keep a mental note. And if you feel like you can match that communication style, then you'll be in good shape. And the 10th item on my ultimate PhD advisor checklist is simply personality. There's lots of different personalities out there, and if you don't mesh well, it's not gonna work out well for you. Now, you don't have to be exactly the same. You really need to mesh. So for example, maybe your advisor is quite passive and timid, and you are kind of assertive and bold. Sometimes that works really well together because you can kind of nudge them along to some degree. Maybe if you're both timid and passive, that actually doesn't work well together because, you know, you're no one is kind of taking initiative, that type of thing. So you want to find kind of convergence in your personality types. One of, I think, the best ways to do that is when you talk to people one-on-one, have an evaluation at the end for yourself where you write down, how did you feel after that? You want to feel positive after speaking with your potential advisor. If you felt meh or negative, then something about the personality didn't work out well. Especially when you're evaluating people and it's very early on in the process, they're on their best performance, just like you are. So you want that to be a really positive, exciting experience. If it's not, then your personalities kind of aren't jiving together. Now, I don't think it is, you know, awful if you don't have a personality match. You know, you certainly do not want to be best friends with your PhD advisor. You can be, but they're going to have to tell you some hard things. They're going to give you some tough love from time to time. So it's really best when you have a professional relationship, but you do want to have a good time. You want to have a happy life. And I think the more that you can find working with someone enjoyable because you connect on a personality type level, the better off you'll be. That's it for my ultimate PhD advisor checklist. All of these are just rules of thumb. If the advisor you're evaluating doesn't meet some of these, that's okay. This would be a slam dunk if you were able to check off all the items on this list. But know that there are priorities. Some of these items might be more important to you than others. So just realize that they're not all equally weighted in your own mind, and it will vary person to person in terms of what's most or less important to them. I hope you found this video useful. If you did so, please hit the like button and consider subscribing for more content on academic success.